Hello, welcome to Connie Martinson Talks Books. Well, talk books, you also talk screenplays. And my guest today, Tom Lazarus, is a professor at UCLA Extension on a masterclass in screenwriting. This book is called The Last Word, and it's published by Michael Wiese Productions. Welcome, Tom Lazarus.
Thank you for having me here.
My pleasure. What a book.
Oh, thank you.
Based on, really, I guess, what you do with your students, whether they're here or you work through the internet.
Yeah, I do both on-site and online teaching. And that way I reach students all around the world who don't really have a chance to get local Hollywood, Los Angeles professionalism as a part of their career. So it's a wonderful thing for some of these foreign students, foreign around the world.
When they get it around the world, are there places that can produce it, that they can see it in action?
Yes, I worked for a while with a group in Kazakhstan, and they had a whole screenwriting school. They used me as one of their instructors, and they ended up making a number of the pictures. The director just came out with a picture in the States, the Abraham Lincoln vampire movie. He was the director of
now,
that.
Now, you refer to yourself in the book as a teacher who takes no prisoners. Now, what do you mean by that?
Well, I've had a lot of practical experience of working staff, writing features, getting features made, writing, directing. And it's a very tough, hard world. And because I teach advanced, and because I teach masterclass, I am trying to play by the same game the industry plays, which is don't hold hands. You got to put it on the page. You got to deliver. We're adults. I'm not going to hold your hand. I'm not going to force you to the computer. You want to be a writer? Write.
Yeah.
So it's kind of a tough love, take no prisoners approach. If they don't want to write, they're not a writer.
Yeah, you know, I loved where somebody at the end is asking you about, oh, I'm so afraid to write. I've got writer's block. Well, if you got writer's block, you're not a writer.
You can't. I knew a writer. He would do everything he could possibly do but write.
Yeah.
And at the very last minute, he would deliver the draft. And it was only, unfortunately, one draft. He hadn't had enough time to make enough changes to make it good. And writers continually put things in their way to stop them from writing. How they prepare, should they do the laundry, should they go to Starbucks.
Yeah.
When your life depends on the food that you put on the table by how efficiently you work at the computer, at least it drove me to be very efficient.
Yeah. You talked too about how writing that script, things have changed. It isn't the same old how scripts were written in Frank Capra's era.
I laugh because sometimes teaching this gets me in trouble. What I do is I teach three-act structure. I understand what that is. I've written it. I've taught it. I teach something else. I teach an alternative paradigm. My belief is, and this is going to take a moment, but my belief is that the three-act structure, which was 30 pages first act, 30 or 60-page second act, 30-page third act, doesn't need to be done anymore. We're much more impatient for information. We know much more. We don't have to be informed and set up and do backstory. We get things so fast now because of fast images and the...
It's the MTV generation.
Absolutely right. It started there. It started with faster and faster cutting and faster understanding and texting. And things move fast. We tell our stories in 140 characters. Things are different. And so if you continue to write with the three-act structure, I believe that the readers who, think of a development person who goes home with a stack of 20 scripts to read, and if every script takes 30 pages to get going, to get to the story that they want, they'll kill themselves. So I know.
No, they close it and throw it on the trash.
It's the same thing.
Yeah.
I mean, they don't kill themselves, they kill you as the writer.
Yeah.
So you have to get your story out, you have to do it fast. The three-act structure may not be the best way to tell your story. What the real issue for me is, do you write stories that fit into formulas or don't you? For me, it never makes sense to have every story structured the same. It's not logical to me that every story would have the same on page 24 an inciting incident on page 27, whatever the rest of those things are. It just doesn't make sense to me. I teach looking for the integrity of the story and finding that and responding to that.
What is the A story?
What is the A story, exactly? And just to talk more about this, the thing, I read lots and lots of scripts, I judge competitions, I have submissions to my class, so I read a lot of scripts, and they don't start, I'm sorry, I lost my train of thought.
Yeah, about the A story.
Oh, the
so
biggest,
so that you don't clutter it up.
Exactly. The thing that I find in most scripts that don't work for me is that the A story isn't totally realized. And it isn't totally realized because the writer has to service the B, C, and D stories. So they don't have enough sense of fulfillment on that A story, and the script lacks it. When I teach only write the A story, don't write backstory, don't write exposition. 115 pages, 105 pages, to get that A story rich and full and satisfying, it takes that.
And don't try to tell the director how to direct as you're writing it.
Well, it's okay when you're directing, but when you're not, nobody really cares about what the writer, how the writer would shoot the shot. There are exceptions always to everything. If it's important to tell the story, if the shot, the description of the shot tells the story, a key point in the story, then put it in, of course. But how you would open the scene with a tight shot of a bird feet, give me a break.
Yeah. The book, in some ways, is like letters from Tom to aspiring writers, where you have read the script and you're telling the author of it, listen, don't let it go here. It slinks. Don't put that on the page. It's too cluttered.
It's what's unique, I think, about this book is that it's not theory. It's not academia. There are absolute real examples of scripts that have gone wrong in some part. So I've taken that over the course of the years. Because I work online, I have lots of notes. I write lots of notes to email notes and letters to writers. I've saved those. I've saved the writing. And what I do in this book is to use the example, practical, real writers' problems. Not theory, not how the history of screenwriting, but here's a problem. I mean, there are over 100 chapters in that book, and they're all broken down by the work that came in and how I responded to it to make it better.
Yeah, and sometimes they have said to you, I don't care, this is what I'm gonna stick with, and they're wrong.
But you know, they're also right. My name doesn't go on the script. Theirs does. It's their call. I can tell them my experience, what I think works, and believe me, I do. And I hound them, I call them, no, I don't. but I do, I mean, I'm very passionate about what I believe. But there is no one right answer. I'm not necessarily right. I think I know what works. I know what's worked for me. I know what works for my students. I know they excel.
Yeah.
But ultimately, Joe America's name's going to be on that script. He should make the decision. He should go out with what he believes in.
But if they're not willing to rewrite, then, you know, I used to have a feel about when computers came in, that people who had written a novel, and they had rewritten it and retyped it, and finally it was bought. They got some money and they bought a computer. And when they got the computer, they suddenly typed it up and on that screen in front of them. It looked like a page, it smelled like a page, and it also did not smell right, and they thought they had written a book, and that's why second books often do not come off.
It's the same thing in screenwriting.
Yeah.
If you read it and it's formatted correctly and you've written the end, there are some writers who think it's finished. If you're not prepared to rewrite, you're not prepared to write.
Yeah.
The cliche is writing is rewriting, and it's true. I have, when I, in my classes, I go around the room and they talk to me about the scripts they've submitted, and I say, well, how many drafts have you done? And they'll go one or two or three or four, and then I'll say, let me tell you who your competition is out there. Your competition is me. I do 10 drafts to get to a rough draft. I do 10 more drafts to get to a first draft. Two drafts, 20 drafts.
Yeah.
Which is better? It's mathematical. The more you write, the better your script gets.
And one of the things I thought interesting was that you do say how it looks on the page, though.
Absolutely.
Don't clutter it.
Well, it's a seduction. You have to make it easy for the reader. You have to make the experience of reading your script enjoyable. You don't want it to be hard. I mean, I had a writer once who wrote me back saying, well, I'm trying to punish the reader. Please,
yeah.
Please, don't punish the reader. You know, yeah. You want to seduce them. I mean, what I believe is that you can't wait 30 pages to hook them. You need to hook them in the first 3 to 5 pages. Once you hook them, you never let go, ever, not for a moment. And that's our job. And that's a seduction. And to get that right takes a lot of work.
Adapting a book, a novel, into a screenplay. Some of the pros and cons.
Pros is you have this wealth of material to work from. Just a wealth of material. The cons are you can only use an eighth of the words and an eighth of the ideas, and you have to be able to look at that novel and find out what the essence of that novel is that translates to the cinema. Novels are all in the head. We can talk about what they're thinking. In film, we don't really do that much. We do voiceover, but we don't do it that much. And it's a different game. And you have to be able to make that transition, and you have to be able to transfer your loyalty from the wonderful book that you are adapting to your screenplay. And if you can't worry about that writer's feelings and you can't worry about that book, you have to have what works as a script and as a movie. Hard.
Did you ever know of Sidney Box, who wrote Carry On,
sure,
Nurse?
Sure, sure.
Sidney was a friend, and I said to him, Sidney, here's a book. I really think it'll make a good film. Took it home, read it, came back and said, you know, Connie, I think the movie in your mind is better than what's on the page. Yeah.
I mean, what we do, I believe, when people read scripts, they see the movie in their mind.
Yeah.
For example, when transitions don't work on the page, when they're not thought about and they're not visually correct, and most screenwriters make this mistake, I think when we see the movie in our mind, there's a disconnect. There's a bad cut in that.
Yeah.
Enough of those, people put your script down.
Beginning your screenplay, which I imagine must be following what you do with students who come in on the first night.
Mm-hmm. Beginning your screenplay is, it's like dating a new girl. It's, you know, it's a fresh body and a fresh mind, and it's fantastic. The idea is to let yourself go free, let yourself don't censor any idea, have a number of files in your computer, list every idea that comes to you. Then after a short amount, do research, and then after a short amount of time, it's gonna start to coalesce. At least for me, I can only take notes for a certain amount of time and do enough research when I have to write it. And what I do is I always make sure that I'm organized. I don't just write. I have a scene list that I've worked on, and I take all